Jesus knocks on the door of your heart. You open that door and you let him in. You turn away from your sin. You turn away from yourself. You turn to the Savior. You receive him as your Savior and your Lord, and you're gloriously born again. That's what the Bible teaches. But then what? What can you expect out of this relationship with Jesus? Let me put it another way. What are the benefits of being born again? What are the benefits of being born again? Let's take a look at Romans chapter 5, verses 1 through 6. I believe there we may get a little insight. The Bible says, therefore, since we have been justified through faith, that means we've been made right with God, our faith didn't make us right with God, it gave us the access to being made right with God. Let me say this perfectly clear. It's not you and Jesus, and that ends up getting you into heaven. It's all about Jesus. You didn't do nothing except accept it. Therefore, since we have been justified through faith, F-A-I-T-H, forsaking all, I trust him, being Jesus, through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord. That means he's the boss. Are we clear on that? That means that the moment that we ask Jesus to come into our heart, we stop making the primary decisions for our lives. We stop making the secondary decisions for our lives. We stop making the decisions for our lives. It's not our call, it's his. Amen? I say amen? Amen. Therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, verse 2, through whom we have gained access. We're going to talk about this in just a moment. Gained access by faith. Our faith opens the door, granting us that access. Where? Into this grace, we just sang about that, in which we now stand. What does that mean to stand in something? It means that you haven't fallen over. It means that although your knees are weak, it means that you may have gone through something, you may be going through something right now that seemingly is about to crush you. But by faith, you rise up knowing, if God be for me, who dare be against me? And I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. And you muster it up, looking to Jesus, saying, help me up. And when you get up, you stand and you lift your head and you put your chest out and you say, I am a child of the Most High God. I am somebody. Amen? Amen. The grace in which we now stand, and we boast in the hope. Not wishful thinking, but the hope of the glory of God. Not only so, verse 3, not only so, but we also glory in our sufferings. By that is a strange concept, is it not? How many of us get on our knees and say, oh God, please let me be in pain. Oh God, please bring me problems. Oh God, please bring me affliction. Oh God, I beg of thee. If you do that, we do have a counseling center in our church. We're going to talk about what that means too. But we glory in our sufferings. Why? Because we know that suffering produces perseverance. Perseverance produces character. And character produces hope. Verse 5, and hope does not put us to shame. We do all of this and we're not embarrassed by it. We're not ashamed of it nor him. We love Jesus and we don't give a rip what anybody thinks about it. And hope does not put us to shame. Why? Because God's love has been poured out into our hearts. I'm glad it didn't just say, you know, trickled, sprinkled, little spritz. Poured, say poured. No, say it like it mean, like you mean it. Poured. Poured out into our hearts. That means it's there and it's overflowing. There's a whole, there's more than enough to go around. Poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit. We know who that is, right? That's the third person of the triune God. That is the only agent of God in the earth right now. That is the one who is in this place right now. In you and on you, child of God, through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. That happens the moment we give our lives to Jesus. And verse 6, you see, at just the right time, not chronos, tick, tick, tick of the clock, but kairos, that's the word in Greek, at the specific, correct, right moment, exactly when we needed it most. At the right time, when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. In these six verses, Paul presents 10 benefits of being born again. Benefit number one, peace. Say peace. Peace. The first benefit of being born again is peace with God. Peace with God. In Romans 5:1, Paul writes, therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we placed our faith in Jesus, and it has put us in a right relationship with God and in a right relationship with others. We now have peace with God. How? Through our Lord Jesus Christ. Peace with God. Now, why do we need peace with God? Now, you're probably thinking, I just need some peace. I just need some serenity. I just need these crazy people around me. Leave me alone. But why do we need peace with God? Why is that first and foremost? Later in the same chapter, Paul paints us a vivid picture of what we were like before we came to Jesus. Now, I don't know about you, but he's never let me forget. But sometimes we can get further down the road, and it is a long-forgotten memory, what we were like before we came to Christ. I still bear scars of the life I used to live. And I'm grateful for them, but sometimes we forget. And then sometimes there are those of us, God bless you, and I admire you. You did it right. Somebody raised you right. Somebody had you in church, and you can't remember a time in your life never believing in Jesus. And you gave your heart to him, and God bless that. But I'm saying that somewhere along the road, we tend to forget that even in that scenario, there was a time when we didn't belong to him. Watch this here. In Romans 5:8, Paul writes, but God demonstrates, that means he shows us, shows up and shows off, he shows us, demonstrates his own love for us, that while we were still sinners, say sinners, while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Let me explain, if I can teach for a moment here. The word sin in the Greek is the word hamartia. Say hamartia. It literally means missing the mark. If you could imagine a target that has circles on it, whether you're shooting a gun or throwing darts or whatever you might be doing, and you're trying to hit the bull's eye. There are many of us who, if we're playing darts, for an example, we'll throw a dart and we'll get close, but we don't hit the bull's eye. What this word hamartia means is that some of us are closer than others, but none of us have hit the bull's eye. None of us are perfect. None of us have lived up to the standard of righteousness that God demands, not suggests, but demands, and he will accept no other. And that's the boat we're in. And the bad things, bad words, bad attitudes, bad actions that come out of that sin's plural, come from something called sin singular, where at some point in our lives, we say to God, I won't be the boss. I don't want you to tell me nothing. Ain't nobody going to tell me what to do. I'm going to be my own boss. I'm going to be the master of my fate, the captain of my ship. I'm going to run my life. I'm going to be free. And what we don't understand is that at that exact moment, we are in more bondage than we've ever been in before, because we've been now cut off from the life source. And just like flowers and their beauty are cut and put in a vase out for display, the longer they're there, it doesn't matter if you cut the stems. It doesn't matter if you add nutrients to the water. Before long, they begin to wilt and brown and die. And so for many of us, the process of death is just working itself out. That's sin's plural. Romans 5:10. So you see, that's where we were before Jesus. Romans 5:10 elaborates on this point, telling us, For if while we were God's enemies, we were reconciled to him, that means we were brought from that lost estate into a found estate. We were brought from being away from God to being reconnected with him. For if while we were God's enemies, we were reconciled to him through the death of his son on the cross, how much more, having been reconciled, shall we be saved through his life? Here Paul presents two words that characterize who we were before we knew Jesus, or two words that would characterize you, my friend, if you don't know Jesus: sinners and enemies of God. Sinners and enemies of God. Say, well, that doesn't sound very nice. It's not. It's not intended to be. Sometimes we can just be so nice to folks, we never share Jesus with them because we don't want to offend them. We don't want to hurt their feelings. Let me explain something to you. We're going to talk about this thing, but we're in the midst of it. Peace with God does not always mean being nice. Peace with God means that you enter into situations where you bring what it means to experience the peace of God when you are in a reconciled relationship with him. And sometimes you got to build a relationship with somebody, investing into that emotional and relational bank account, because you're going about to write a check on that. You're about to use your credit card and make a charge on that, because you're going to have to look somebody in the face and say, can we talk? And you begin to share with them about who this Jesus is, and then you look at them and say, let me ask you a question. When you get to after you leave this life one day and you stand before God and he looks you in the eye and he says, why should I let you into my heaven? What you gonna tell him? Now, that's not the kind of thing that you usually walk up to a total stranger and say. I have, Gene, I know you have, I know a lot of us have, and God's because God told us to. But usually we got to build a relationship to make that happen, because then we've earned a hearing. And then when we say that, they'll give us one of three answers. They'll say, it's because Jesus loves me and died for me on the cross, and that's the only reason. Or you usually hear the answer, well, I just do the best I can, and I hope that's enough. Or you hear somebody say, I don't have a freaking idea. That's when you get to tell them what the freaking idea is. You get to explain to them about the love of God expressed through Christ Jesus and how they can be gloriously born again. But that doesn't mean that you're just always nice. Always nice. Now listen, I like you to be nice. Some of y'all need to be nicer. I'm just keeping it real. You know? You don't always need to be walking around mad at folks, you know, or walking around with your lip hanging the ground having somebody trip over it. You don't need to be looking like somebody smacked you in the face with a lemon. You know what I'm saying? But what I am saying is that the peace of God and bringing peace into, the peace of God into situations does not always mean that you're just smiley and sweet, syrupy. So, peace with God means, watch this, that we are a couple of things. We need to understand some things here. These verses tell us that Jesus addressed our problem head on. Jesus went to the cross and took away our sin. Jesus paid the penalty for our sin, reconciling us to God, transforming us from lost enemies of God to friends of God, and not only that, children of God. And if we are willing to place our total confidence in what Jesus did for us on that cross, God sees us, watch this, as if we never, ever sinned at all. He looks through, as many of us who have spectacles on our eyes or contact lenses in our eyes, we see through lenses so that we can see life more clearly. God the Father looks through the crimson, God help me, the crimson flow of Jesus, looks through that lens and sees not our fallen estate, but sees us as the perfection of God because of what Jesus has done for us on the cross. And the first benefit that we receive from being born again is that we experience peace. What is that? Peace with ourselves. Irene, serenity, the kind of thing where you can go, you know, I'm not what I ought to be, but thank God I'm not what I used to be. I'm on my way. And I slip and I fall and it's not what I want to do, but God lifts me back up and gets me on the way again. And I'm at peace with that. No, I may not have lived up to my own expectations. I may not have lived up to the expectations of others. But when I follow Jesus, I'm always going to fulfill his expectations of me. And even though I may have wasted the years behind me, God's going to give those years back to me with interest. And he's going to make the most of the time that I have to glorify him, share his son with others, and advance and build up the kingdom of God. Peace with ourselves, peace with others. My goodness, if you have never experienced conflict in your life, it means you've never experienced a Christmas holiday season. In the stores, in the grocery stores, in your homes. Good night. Do not go out on a Friday or a Saturday and try to go shopping in this fair city of Bowie unless you are driving some type of military apparatus with a turret and a, you know, a tank, a something. People are crazy. And for the love of all, get out. Does anybody around here understand what a turn signal is? And would you get your brake lights fixed? I don't see very well, so I'm kind of like, you know, it's a struggle for me to begin with. My goodness. Peace with others. And most importantly, as we've said, peace with God. When we quit running, when we quit resisting, and when we quit rebelling, and when we accept Jesus, we have peace with God. Let me break this down for you. Peace with God means that we are no longer at war with God. Peace with God puts us on the side of God. The peace of God gives us indestructible joy. Let me say that again. The peace of God gives us indestructible joy. So no matter what you're facing on your job, no matter what you're facing in your home, no matter what you're facing in your neighborhood, no matter what you're facing in your health, your finances, your relationship, your children have lost their minds, glory to God. No matter what you're up against, the joy Jesus others you that he gives you through a relationship with him is indestructible. And nobody can take that from you unless you let them. Now smack your neighbor and say, don't you dare let them. Don't you dare let them. The peace of God gives us an indestructible joy regardless of what we are going through. So hear me now. Hear me now. So if you are going through hell, keep going. Peace awaits you on the other side. Amen. Going through those spiritual bodybuilding exercises produces spiritual maturity. Spiritual maturity is a depth of understanding and strength of faith that allows you to rest in God. You can rest in God knowing, and I mean really experientially knowing, that he is large and he is in charge. You see, you really know that Jesus is your shepherd. You really know that Jesus is your king. You really know that Jesus is in total control. You really know that no circumstance and no situation can disrupt, interrupt, or remove you from the protective arms of God. Give him some praise. The first benefit of being born again is what? Say it with me. Peace. Second benefit of God is access. In verse 2 of Romans chapter 5, the Bible says, through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace in which we now stand, and we boast in the hope of the glory of God. The first part of this verse tells us through whom, that's Jesus, we have gained access by our faith. Our faith opens the door and lets us in. It gets us to places that otherwise we could not go. We have access to God. Why? Because we are born again. Let me make this perfectly clear. One of the reasons why I don't use the term very often today, the term Christian, is because there are so many different definitions of that term. There are those who would say, I'm a Christian because I go to church. There are those who would say, I am a Christian because I have been baptized, catechized, homogenized, whatever. There are those who would say, I am a Christian because I do good works, or I serve in my community, or I give to good causes. But the Bible says the only Christian that there is one that is born again, that has turned away from the garbage in their life and turned to God, turned away from the junk in their life and turned to Jesus, and by a decision that they have made, not that somebody else made for them, a decision they have made, they ask Jesus to come into their lives and gloriously save them, and they experience what the Bible says, being born again. That is what a Christian is. Am I clear? I say, am I clear? I don't want anybody to go out of here saying, well, I'm a Christian because I came to church. That'd be like me going to Giant and telling you that I'm, you know, a waffle. Just because you show up someplace don't mean that's what you is. If you'll allow me to assassinate the king's English. Well, we are never out of God's reach. Aren't you glad? We are never out of God's reach. We are always just a prayer away. By faith, trusting in the completed work of Christ upon the cross, you and I are born again. And as born again believers, we have direct access to God himself. We have no reason to feel left out. We have no reason to feel lonely. We have no reason to deal with the hand that life has dealt us all by ourselves. We have a Savior who has saved us. We have a Father who has loved us. We have a Spirit that is inside us. The whole family of God, the church, surrounds us. And let me tell you, that's a mighty big family. We have a hotline to the throne of God that is never busy, never puts us on hold, and never tells us to leave a voicemail and God will get back to us. We can talk to God anytime, any place, anywhere. The second benefit of being born again is access to God. Give him some praise. Man, that's good stuff. That is good stuff right there. Benefit number three. Benefit number three, grace. We've spent a good time this morning speaking to this, singing about this. Let's address it one more time. I cast your gaze once again on the second verse in today's text. Verse 2 says, we have gained access by faith into this grace, into this grace in which we now stand. What is grace? Grace is the unearned, unmerited, undeserved favor and forgiveness of God. Favor and forgiveness of God. And I want to make this perfectly clear. For all of us, not excluding any of us, we do not deserve God's grace. We do not deserve God's favor. We do not deserve God's forgiveness. We do not deserve to be in the family of God. We do not deserve to be in the body of Christ. We do not deserve any of it. That's why we need grace. And that's why it's called grace. God, by his grace, watch us now, has transferred, say transferred, has transferred his righteousness, his dikaiosune righteousness, from him upon us. We have the very righteousness of God right now. The grace of God looks at the likes of you and me, covered in the blood of Jesus, and that alone makes us acceptable to God. Because of grace, we are made worthy to be numbered among God's family. Because of grace, we are made worthy to be vital parts of the body of Christ. You see, it is God's grace that keeps us alive. It is God's grace that allows us to recover when we stray. It is God's grace that allows us to recover when we fail. And it is God's grace that allows us to recover when we fall. Grace is the greatest motivator we have to living a Christian life. Grace and grace alone. Verse 2 tells us that this grace is that in which we now stand. Coming to God and accepting His grace for our salvation is but the beginning of our journey with Jesus. Let me say that again. Accepting this grace that God gives us through Jesus is but the beginning of the journey, not the end of it. It's the beginning of the journey. Let me teach for a second here. God's greater grace prepares us for God's surpassing grace. Let me say this again. Coming to God and accepting His grace for salvation is the beginning of our journey. And this introduces us to God. I got ahead of myself. I was so excited. This introduction to God's grace invites us to grow in that grace so that we can discover and experience what's called God's greater grace. Say God's greater grace. Greater grace is spiritual maturity. And that spiritual maturity, God's greater grace, prepares us for God's surpassing grace. So now you got grace, greater grace, and surpassing grace. Grace that gets you saved. Surpassing grace, which is maturity in your faith. Now, what is this surpassing grace? Surpassing grace carries us through the transitions of life. From temporary to eternal, from our breathing our last breath on earth to our breathing our next breath in heaven. Grace, you come to Jesus, surpassing grace. That's the way that you live in Jesus. And that the greater grace is how you live in Jesus, and the surpassing grace is what you experience when you are translated from this side of eternity to the next. How many of you are up for some grace today? Amen. Up for some grace. Grace, greater grace, surpassing grace. Say that with me. Grace, greater grace, surpassing grace. The third benefit of being born again is the grace of God. Benefit number four. Benefit number four of being born again is glory. Say glory. Glory. Verse 2 goes on to tell us that all who are born again can boast in the hope of the glory of God. Now, I can hear some of you saying, even those of you that are online or watching on TV, I can hear you through the screen. I can hear you saying, hey, Jimmy, didn't you tell us that bragging wasn't biblical? And I would say unto you, you are correct. Bragging about yourself, bragging about what you have, bragging about what you've done, bragging about your titles and your trophies, your citations and your certificates, your education, your occupation, what others say about you, and more importantly, what you say about yourself to anybody and everybody that's willing to stand there and listen. That's not biblical. And God hates that kind of arrogance, by the way. So, if God hates that expression of pride, what is he talking about here? In Romans chapter 1, verse 30, Paul describes the arrogant and boastful as God haters. So then what is Paul talking about when he's talking about boasting in Jesus? Watch this now. We are boasting in the hope of the Lord means giving glory, praise, and honor to God for who he is and what he has done. Boasting in the Lord is not self-seeking. Boasting in the Lord is not self-gratifying. Rather, boasting in the Lord is centered around the Lord Jesus, who deserves all of our glory and our praise. The hope of glory is the fulfillment of God's promise to restore us and all of creation. Total restoration. It may look bad now, but a better day's coming. It may look messed up now, but a better day's coming. It may look like it's all gone and it's over and done, but a better day's coming. God's going to straighten this whole thing out. He's going to make it right. God's going to make it right. And this hope, my brothers and sisters in Christ, is not wishful thought, but the confident, expectant, joyful knowledge that we are being changed by God and will one day see Christ face to face, having been conformed to his image. What is that benefit of being born again? That's number four. It is that wonderful benefit of glory. Today we have discovered four benefits of being born again. Let's say them together. Benefit number one is what? Peace. Benefit number two, access. Number three, grace. Benefit number four, glory. Now next week we will continue our exploration of the 10 benefits of being born again. Here's a sneak peek. Benefit number five, perseverance. Benefit number six, character. Benefit number seven, hope. Benefit number eight, confidence. Benefit number nine, love. And benefit number 10, the Holy Spirit. Until then, I would say unto you, if you are not born again, here in the house, or you that are with us online or on television, what in God's name are you waiting for? What are you waiting for? All these things that we've talked about here today, they can be yours just for the asking. But more than that, not just asking for the benefits, but asking for the benefactor, asking for Jesus himself. And I would say unto you, if you are born again, take advantage of your benefits, my born-again brothers and sisters in Christ. For I say unto you, that's what they are there for. Let's give him some praise. Come on.
Come on. That message, so, so powerful. It's an amazing message with practical tools. Right now in the chat, give somebody a high five. Don't click off. I know you might think that service is over, but it's not. We still have some amazing information to share with you. We have one question for you today. You just heard an amazing sermon, so what are you going to do about it? The first step is to give your life to Christ. If you've never given your life to Christ, why not today? You don't get it by watching us. You don't get it by rules or rituals. You get it by having a personal, real relationship with Christ. If you want that today, pray this with me right now. Jesus, come into my heart. I receive you as my Lord and Savior. God, I give you my life. I give you total control of my life. I believe you are who you say you are, and I believe everything the Bible said you did. And I ask you to come into my life. I know that I'm a sinner, and I ask for forgiveness today. I want to trust to follow you as my Lord and Savior. In Jesus Christ's name we pray, amen. If you pray that with me right now, God just came into your heart to live inside of you. I want you to go right now to cresthill.org/connect. This is means for a party. This is means for a celebration. So tell us about your decision that you just made by going to cresthill.org/connect. Don't wait. Go to cresthill.org/connect. There you'll be directed to our church's website, and then you can just click the blue button that says connect. Fill out some information about yourself so that we can celebrate with you today about what you just did. Don't wait. Hit the blue button that says connect today. Also, if you say, hey, I know about Jesus, but I want to find a church home, you can be a part of Cresthill's fellowship wherever you are across the globe. So go to cresthill.org/connect to be a part of our Cresthill family today. So lastly, did you like what you saw today? Have you thought, I would love to spread the message of Jesus across the globe? Then go to cresthill.org/give to do just that. Help us spread the message of Jesus across the globe. God bless you. I also want to invite you to come next week. Matter of fact, don't just come by yourself. Have a watch party with your friends so that all of you can praise God together. Come along with Cresthill next week. We know that your time is precious, so we want to thank you so much for joining us today. We don't take it for granted. You could be doing so many other things this Sunday, but you decided to spend it with Cresthill, so we thank you. So lastly, we love you. God loves you. Never give up, never give in. And as always, keep the faith.